Let's see who's still standing if we say the city is 10 million. Anybody in a city bigger than 10 million? Yes, I can see Gabriel here, a few more. Okay, let's go up to, you can sit down if your city is below 15 million. 15 million? Just this lady here. Could you tell us which city you live in, please? Bangui. Bangui. And what is the population of Bangui? 600,000. It's a big population, more than 15 million. I suspected we might see people from Tokyo still standing up. Well, we may not be a typical group, but the world is moving into cities at breakneck speed. By 2050, two-thirds of the world's population will be urbanized. Sometimes that process of urbanization is carefully planned and orchestrated, but more often it's chaotic or anarchic. And urbanization brings with it some great opportunities, but also a few challenges. Our session this afternoon is all about maximizing the opportunities and minimizing the challenges and dealing with them. So I hope you've all downloaded the app. Do you have it to hand? Can I ask you let's have a look now, because I want you all to contribute. Can we see the first slide, please, about the app? Could you go to that screen on your app? It's the very first one. And then pick this option here called Word Cloud. If we can have the next slide, please. You should see this comes up next. You all getting that? And you clearly pick Active Cities and Healthy Societies. If you can click on that one. Let's see the next slide, please. There we are. And you will see in there a slide where you can input. Yep.
What about if you don't have the app?
If you don't have the app, you're sitting in groups, and you'll find someone in your group who has the app. And what I'd like you to do very quickly is to put one word which describes something fantastic about living in a city. It may be food, it might be opportunity, it might be jobs. You choose, but as quickly as you can, either as a group or just on your own, give me one word that describes something wonderful about living in a city. Go for it, as quickly as you can, please. So we've got variety coming up. Convenience, keep them coming. Opportunities. Have we got some more coming? Anyone still typing? Oh yes, loads. Social. Does that say dock? The Docklands, I guess. Fantastic, here in Buenos Aires. Diversity. Lands, people. Okay, that's terrific. So clearly we all know there are some wonderful things about living in cities. Let's wipe that slate clean. Take that lot off the screen, please. And then let's start again. And this time, can you give me one word which is about the negative aspects of living in a city? What is it you don't like about being in a city? Okay, let's try one more time. If we can wipe off this screen, please, and we'll start again. Yep. Maybe you can contribute to this group. Okay. Uh-huh, they're coming in. Traffic, pollution, crime, stress. Rush, life, that's a bit negative, isn't it? Life, a whole of life. Crowds, congestion. I think we can all equate to that. Are there one or two more coming? Searching. Oh yes, loads and loads. Clearly there's more negatives coming than positives. That may tell us something. Well, thank you for that. Love them or hate them, cities are where most of us will be living. But there is growing evidence, you've presented some of it here, that unless we do something about it, life in cities and the lifestyles associated with city living are going to damage our health, reduce the quality of our life, and probably the length in which we live. City life may be great fun, that's what you were suggesting earlier, but it's increasingly a sedentary life, behind the wheel of a car, behind the screen, behind robotic manufacture with lifts, escalators, and delivery services taking away all the strain of movement. And with that comes obesity, chronic illness, and the epidemic of non-communicable diseases. Our first speaker has studied this in great detail and has led the World Health Organization to come up with a plan to get cities and citizens moving. To summarize what we're dealing with and outline their global action plan for physical activity, we're going to welcome in just a moment the WHO's Program Manager for Prevention of Non-Communicable Diseases, Dr. Fiona Bull. But first, let's take a quick look at a video which shows what the World Health Authority are up to. Play the video, please.
We live in a world beating with urgency, breathing with difficulty, breaking under necessity. We are a society consumed by technology, compact in proximity, choked by inactivity. We are global, we are responsible, we are trending, we are too inactive. Everyone, everywhere, every day. We have a plan. It's time to activate our governments, to activate our environments, to activate our society, to activate ourselves. It's time to activate movement, to activate improvement, to reverse our direction, to activate new trends. We need to alert you. We need to activate. Everyone, everywhere, every day.
Thank you. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I'm delighted to be here from the World Health Organization to share with you why we are passionate and directed at increasing physical activity and the health of citizens in cities. And that video really has said most of what I want to say, but I'd now like to take my time to take you back and explain why we did this and where we're going with you to create more activity in our cities. First of all, those health benefits, many mentioned in the video, but this slide has got 50 years of research science summarized. You can read it, I'm not going to go through them all, but it's physical, mental, and social health benefits that come from playing sport and being active. WHO recognized this. It's not new science, and we had a backdrop of policy documents advising countries what they should do. Nothing was happening. No one was listening because there were other priorities. But in 2011, a major United Nations meeting identified non-communicable diseases as the leading cause. And this morning we heard Thomas Bach mention this. A plan was put into place which included physical activity and included the first target, 10% improvement. And we need to improve. Latest data, 1 in 4 adults are inactive, not meeting those benefits, not getting enough physical activity to be active. This is for men and women. This is separated for men and women. Men in blue, gold is women. Women are less active. I highlight this because we spoke this morning about the importance of women's engagements, and it's true for women's engagements in physical activity for health benefits. 5 to 10% difference, often up to 20% difference in different countries. Latest data, I've broken down the same numbers by the regions of the world. Look at the patterns and look where we are. For those who can see, apologies, for those that can see, we have high levels in Latin America here, and over 2001 to 2016, the problem is getting worse. If the graph goes up, it's getting worse, and it's either static or getting worse in most of those regions, up to 50% or higher in some countries. This is the most worrying. The trends that that video introduced are happening here in Argentina and elsewhere. As countries develop, through middle income, changes in economy, changes in transport, changes in cities, we get less active. High-income countries are less active. So we can see where the future is for India, for China, for Brazil, for Argentina, unless we act. An action plan was called for by the 194 states of the World Health Organization. Give us a new plan, link with the Sustainable Development Goals. We did, and over a course of the last year, we talked with everyone, including the sports community. Photos here from meetings and consultations, debating and challenging, how do we solve this problem? The solution was found and written into one of our highest documents, the resolution of the World Health Organization in May this year. And it calls for action in all countries to support governments and cities to promote physical activity. What does it say? The 10% I've already introduced you to, but aim higher, aim out to 2030 for 15% improvement. That's every one of your countries changing levels of participation by 15%. How are we going to do it? We're going to do it by making sure that everyone has access to the facilities, the environments, and the programs. Let me tell you some more. Four objectives: to improve the environment, number two in green, to improve the programs of sports for all, for women, for older, for children in yellow, to have people recognize the benefits. We need to give them more information and knowledge. We need to promote being active in red. And lastly, in blue, we need to measure and monitor and reward success, but point out inaction. And we need to say more about this. There's something wrong in this photo. That is the norms of society. That is a medical conference. I took the photo. Our norms are looking at sitting down, at the easy option. We need to change this. I've mentioned the details about education. We have the skills, we know how to do it, we know marketing works. Think about your city. Can you walk to a shop? Could your children walk to school safely? Do they? We have to challenge how our cities are designed and the access to the places and spaces, the cycleways, the parks, the playgrounds, and the pavements. That is too often the cities that we have. We need to provide the programs, and we need to measure so we actually have the data and successes and evaluation. We've put the plan together. It forms a system, an ecosystem. It's not about one of those, it's about all of those. And it's all of us, health, environment, transport, sport, working together, contributing to any one of those areas. If we did it together, we could actually change those data which have been static for the last 15 years. It can be done. This photograph is showing you a before and after. We live in cities that have been dominated by car design. We've lost our playgrounds and parks. But here you see pedestrianization. people back in the cities, and that's really important, and my fellow speakers will talk to it. Our Director General agrees, and the sustainable developments can be contributed through sport and physical activity in many of the ways that we all know. And I invite us to look at this plan, to see how we can contribute to it so we can create a more active world, a healthier world, and more environmentally sustainable. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Fiona. Yes, do take a seat. Some scary statistics there, but also good to see World Health Organization taking a really proactive lead. There'll be many questions. We'll come back to you if we may later, but for the moment, join us. So in addition to the WHO Global Action Plan, there are, of course, cities and organizations who are taking their own action and seeing, perhaps, a better future. Indeed, the IOC and the WHO are amongst the organizations which are backing a number of those other initiatives. A major new project which has been supported by the IOC is called the Global Active City Program. It was created to help cities empower their residents to make their long-term lifestyles change, to be more active in their daily lives, and therefore happier and healthier. They say it's not about people who are already doing sports, it's about making physical activity accessible for everyone, especially those at risk through inactivity. I guess we've all seen too often that services such as health and social care, urban planning and sport operate independently in silos. Well, global active cities are the ones that can break down those frontiers to get people active and healthier. The point of the program, as I hope you'll hear, is that it's evidence-based. It's not enough for simple cities to simply say they're doing the project. They have to work with local universities and expert evaluators to test out what they've done and to prove that they've successfully improved physical activity and health and the lifestyle and well-being of their populations. Well, we have three cities who can tell us how they've put the program into action. And the first off the blocks is, and indeed it's the role model for the Global Action Program, is the UK city of Liverpool. In a moment, we'll welcome the clinical director for the NHS Liverpool Clinical Commissioning Trust, Dr. Maurice Smith. But first, let's see through a video a little of what Liverpool is up to.
Fit for me. Three words that are changing the way we think about being active. You see, it doesn't have to be about running marathons or going to the gym. Being active can be anything that you want it to be. It's all about doing something that fits your needs and helps make life better for you. It doesn't matter what shape, size, or age you are. Running around with his son left Paul out of breath.
I walk and I box, so I've got energy, so I'm full with my family.
And Phil might not be as young as he used to be.
I walk and swim because it helps me sleep better and feel good.
There's a way for everyone to join in, whether you've been active in the past or an absolute beginner, like Debbie was.
I run because it makes me feel incredible and it's changed my life.
Or if you've got a new baby to look after like Romina.
I love walking because it cheers me up when I'm feeling low.
Maybe you've got a busy life like Des.
I play football to keep myself healthy, clear my head and have a laugh with the lads.
Maybe you need to balance being a mum with getting active, like Diana.
I run because it makes me feel amazing, healthy and strong.
Or you might just want to join in and feel good. Betty does Zumba.
It's given me a new found sense of empowerment and confidence.
Whatever your reason, whatever your lifestyle, being active is something that can make each and every one of us feel good. It can give us more energy, help us sleep better, reduce stress and boost our confidence too. So join in with free local activities, special offers and motivational support at fitforme.info.
Fit for me.
Join in.
Feel good.
Yeah, it's great to see there the spirit that anybody who knows Liverpool will know exists. But Maurice, Liverpool may have a proud sporting heritage, but frankly, it's not known as a sporting or a city famous for its fitness and activity, is it?
No, indeed. Before we started this campaign, Liverpool was well recognised.
Close as you can.
to be an area of high deprivation with low levels of physical activity, actually, and significant problems. Half the city is obese, 25% of the population still smoke. We have higher death rates from cancer. So really some significant health problems across the city.
So tell us what actions you decided to take and why.
So we decided to look at prevention, what to do, what to make our most important priority. And we decided between the commissioning group, the health and the social care sector, that physical activity would be our number one programme for improving health across the whole city, for all the reasons Fiona talked about, because of those very specific benefits.
So prevention was clearly the big priority. What were the concrete actions you took to achieve that?
So a number of things that we did. We formed a joint physical activity and sports strategy group between the City Council and the Clinical Commissioning Group that we take joint responsibility for and we fund into. We built on working relationships that we'd established already in the city well before I took a position. In actual fact, we had a stakeholder group for sports and physical activity. But one of the first things we did was we changed it to a physical activity and sports strategy group to try and include the whole population, make it a much more inclusive program and priority.
You used the word, I think they're joined up, and it's something we touched on earlier. Just how difficult is it to get those different sectors and agencies to play together?
What I would say is it's not impossible. There are significant challenges, but it depends on taking the priority and addressing it as a priority and lining everything up. So if it's a priority, get behind it, advocate for it. And one of the things that we're able to do through myself and the Clinical Commissioning Group, but also colleagues in health and colleagues in social care, taking that really seriously and advocating for that as our number one priority, linking with schools, linking with businesses, constantly making the case to take people with us.
So it sounds great. What evidence have you got that it's worked?
Okay, so we've got quite a bit of stuff that we've done, we're pleased to see. We've worked with a number of businesses in the city. We have over 50 businesses signed up. We've got 82,000 people have engaged in the programme through businesses alone. What I would say from my point of view as a doctor is that the jewel in the crown for me has been our engagement with primary care, with healthcare. We've taken the primary care population of GPs and practice nurses along with us in this programme. And whereas before, doctors and nurses weren't really asking people about how physically active they were, back in 2016, we'd probably find no records of physical activity. Now we've asked over 120,000 people in the city about their levels of physical activity. And where they're not meeting guideline limits, where they're not getting to those 150 minutes a week, conversations have taken place with over 90% of those population to increase their levels. So we've engaged across the whole piece, but we've engaged wider than that. We've used schools and school facilities to open up to their communities. So we've had over 200,000 people in 2015, 2016 through local school facilities to make use of those benefits. And we've also engaged with the various sports clubs through our stakeholder group. So they've offered free events, free coaching, free sessions throughout the city. And we've developed an activity finder. So if you want to get more physically active in the city of Liverpool, you can go to the Fit For Me website. The campaign that you've just seen is the very public-facing aspect of our programme, but it was heavily driven by an insight-developed approach. So we decided to ask the people of Liverpool what they wanted to get out of a programme, not just put a programme onto them.
You talked there about sports clubs, and of course, everybody, I guess, around the world knows about Liverpool and Everton. I was lucky enough to see for myself, and astonished, I have to say, when I went to Liverpool, that both Everton Football Club and Liverpool Football Club are working together on this project. And that says something, given the degree of rivalry between the two clubs.
Yeah, I mean, it's really amazing. We've got Everton in the city, we've got the Liverpool Foundation, and they're doing really important work with us. But more importantly than their work that they're doing it in partnership now. So we've established relationships with both of those great clubs to do the work and to spread best practice. Liverpool Foundation have just launched the Open Goals program, where they're getting kids more active in local parks with local celebrities. I was fortunate enough to go to the launch with one of Liverpool's great footballers, a guy called Robbie Fowler, and it's wonderful to see the kids getting involved.
Morris, Liverpool is a tough city. Some might say it's a unique city. So how replicable is your experience for others?
So I think it's a replicable model, but you've got to get behind it. I think the key is to find some champions, champions in social care, champions in health, champions in business, and support them and get them to work together and get them to network, because it's the networking of those people that will drive the priority. If you can do that, you will raise the priority level, you will raise the visibility of physical activity, and you will start to draw in funding and support that actually oils the wheels to make this type of stuff happen.
Maurice, thank you very much indeed. And if you have a chance, take a look at the photographic exhibition outside, because there's some lovely images taken by one of the commissioned photographers for the IOC to look at Liverpool. It really captures the essence of what Maurice was talking about. Well, let's now go to a very different city, different in, I guess, just about every way. We'll travel to Norway and to the small but beautiful double Olympic city of Lillehammer, and to hear how and why they adopted the Active Cities Programme. Please welcome the Mayor of Lillehammer, Espen Granberg Johnsen.
Thank you. Thanks a lot for inviting me to share some views and experiences seen from Lillehammer. As mentioned, the Olympic flag has been raised two times in our city, and for a city with 28,000 inhabitants, that's might be quite remarkable. And I will start with that because that has of course had a huge impact on our development over the last 25 years in many ways. Of course, infrastructure, both roads and venues, but more important, I think, confidence, inspiration, position as a national and international winter sport destination, and international promotion and contacts. And what I think is probably the most important thing about being an Olympic city, as we have been twice, is that sports and culture now is an important part of our identity, and also, of course, important business in the whole region. We try as best as we can to. We have high ambitions, and we try as best as we can to take care of our Olympic legacy. And we try to bring it with us in all positive ways all the time. And I will say that planning in a municipal perspective, planning is vital. In Norway, we have a wide range of voluntary organizations, like in Liverpool and others. And they offer different activities within sports, within culture, and other interest areas. And this represents a very important resource and cooperation partners for the municipality in the aspect that we are talking about today. Back home, skiing, football, handball, and ice hockey is the most popular sports. And more than 50% of our population is engaged in organized sports clubs and activities. Among children, the participation level is, of course, much higher. But which is a challenge also for us is that many quit when they reach a teenage period. And that's some of the things that we hope to get a better answer on being part of this program. But it is also important to emphasize that all the unorganized activity as well. And a lot of people, and I think if you have been playing football or go skiing when you were a boy or a young girl, then it's easier when you are getting older to also use the nature as a sporting ground. The annual all year around sport events are important to us and to our region. It creates jobs, it boosts tourism, it's good for business, and it helps finance many local clubs because of all the voluntary work which is done during these events. And it's also a big motivational factor for our own population to become active, to take part, to be inspired. And we have seen four areas that have been identified that all interfere with each other. In particular, interactionists are strong between events, facilities, tourism, and top sport, but also sports and education. And as we heard from the earlier speakers, the school system and the importance of the school system in physical activity is also, of course, important to us. So therefore, the role of the municipality is to plan and to develop good facilities and possibilities for all ages. It's about questions about playgrounds, kindergartens and schools, where we locate them. Is it possible to walk through the school, or do we have to use buses or cars? Sports arenas where everyone can take part. Tracks in the nature all year round, information about the benefits of being active, and to inspire for to be active, and that's one of the reasons the Global Active City Program is very useful for us, as we have heard, and that Tavisa and Evalu, who is standing behind the project, is a good. It's good to cooperate with for us, and also supported by the IOC, and as I understand, also UNESCO is interested in being a part of it. We have seen so far in the program that the model is a good tool for joint efforts. Many organizations are doing a very good job, and. They were all eager to participate from the start of the project. Joint efforts makes all efforts stronger, and the model has influenced different municipal plans and activities of the participating organizations. What I will say is an important result so far is that the partners also report on benefits within short time, and we already see results from the work, and we'll keep on doing that hopefully, and together with all the other cities get also good results for Lillehammer and for our society. That's a short brief. Thanks.
Espen, thank you. So I guess we've seen how the model works in a very small city and in what we might call a medium-sized global city. Let's go now, lastly, to a big city. And we're coming home, in a sense, to here in Buenos Aires, and to hear how this city is doing so much more at the moment than simply hosting the Youth Olympic Games. Please welcome the director of the Buenos Aires Active City Project, Eleonora Bauer.
Hello, everyone. It's weird to speak in English in my own country. The beauty of that is that you are here, so we are very, very proud and welcome all of you to the city. Do I have the... Ah, yeah, there. So, this is Buenos Aires. We are in the capital of Argentina. The city of Buenos Aires, we have 3 million people with a complex organization because we double the amount of people every day when they come here to for work. We have a big area in the suburbs, and although this is the richest part of the country, we have a very big difference with the south of the city and the north of the city. You will experience that difference going to the Olympic Park, to the Olympic Villa, and you can see how we use these cues of the Olympic Games to bring development to that area and to try to reduce that difference between the north and the south of the city. So 3 years ago, when we knew we had the games in the city, we started working with the legacy. not only with the development of the south part of the city, but also with another important legacy, which is the public health. What's there with sports and the impact of the sports in the city. So we started working in this active city pathway. The city has we built a lot of bike lanes. We built we have the free bike services you can access in the city. We have a lot of pedestrian zones, a huge pedestrian zone in the city. We improve the public transportation. But all that infrastructure, it's not enough. It's not enough to reduce the sedentarism levels. And today in the city, we have 4 out of 10 kids with overweight as an average. So this is huge. And we understand that the infrastructure is not enough. So with the Active City Program, with this initiative, and working together with the other cities, learning a lot from Liverpool here, Maurice, they were we took a lot of lessons learned from them. So we started moving what we call from sport focus exclusively from a healthy ecosystem, more like Fiona was talking about. So regarding within the city, we also thought about not only the sports. We were talking to people who like sports lovers, and we realized that it wasn't the complete community. So we started talking to the complete community to change the approach. And this is what we call the Buenos Aires Active City. And this is where we build the management system. We audit it, and finally we certify. So now I want to just reinforce 3 lessons learned from the past 3 years, very connected with Fiona and the WHO approach. The first one is this concept of ecosystem, but applied within the city. The second one, it's about the importance of the movement. I call it the movement paradigm. And finally, that all this process, it means culture change. So first one about ecosystem. We need to understand the city as a body which is connected. We need to understand each part of the body and how it is connected if we really want to make a change with sedentarism habits. So we call it the systemic view, and even connecting the dots. For example, and one lesson learned was within the government, we had a lot of programs with education, with sports, with urban, with transport. We had a lot of different programs, but we haven't connected properly each other. As an example, we have here, just in front of this building, you can go and visit our estaciones saludables, the healthy stations. Those healthy stations where you can have your body pleasure within the park, you can have a sugar test, or you can have a conversation with a nutritionist. And apart from that, we have some sports activities, but they weren't connected. So now, after this, the past 3 years, now if you go and say, I want to have my body pressure, and so then the people there say, why don't you try this physical activity just outside? You can go to the running team. And on the other hand, the running team, they say, have you been into the Estación Saludable? Why don't you go there? Why don't you have a conversation there? So we connected all within the park. On the other side, we also connected doctors, the doctors' community, with the physical activity teachers. Having conversations with some doctors, doctor says, you know, at the faculty, at university, we learn about illness. Then at the hospital, we learn a lot about illness. So now I'm with patients and I'm looking for illness. So sometimes I don't know how to talk about well-being and health. So this is something we need to work with the doctor community, with the medical community. how they can back to the basics and have a conversation about what it means well-being, what it means for parents, for kids, talking about well-being. And on the other hand, school teachers, the physical school teachers, also need to have a conversation about well-being and health. So we need both. We did agreement with all medical societies. We put on the other part all the physical activity teachers, and we are putting all together to work as a team. This is ecosystem. Then we understood that sport, it's not enough. And even sometimes sports are preventing a lot of people to go into movement, because especially the kids who are overweight, sometimes they don't want to be there. So we need to understand and see which are other activities that connect with them. Like, for example, dancing. We discovered dancing, it's a great movement. This is Zumba. Do you have Zumba? You are invited next Thursday, October 11, to a huge Zumba session. We are expecting in Buenos Aires, for charity, more than 30,000 people dancing Zumba for a charity session. You are invited. So we discovered that. And finally, culture change. This is, you need to understand that we need to motivate people. Only regulation, it's not enough. We need more than regulations. We need to motivate people to go into movement. So we have to understand that peer motivation, all group activities are important. We need to understand who are the influencers in our society. For example, in Buenos Aires, the local neighborhood clubs, Clubes de Barrio, it's an important institution. It's an extension of the family, so we are working with them. They are geographically distributed into the city. So we need them because they are the one that can influence the family. They are the one with peer motivation. So we are working to strengthen those institutions we need them to put people into movement. And finally, enjoyment. We need people, when we talk also about beyond sports, for example, at schools, we are working with active playgrounds. We are teaching kids how to play into the playground, because all the screens now are terrible, so we need to, again, to teach how to play, actively play. So we are doing that into the play. It's not only sports, it's also playing. So this is finally an important lesson learned from this pathway. So definitely this hosting this game, we did a beautiful job, and we are thankful for having the Olympics as a huge motivation for the city. It's a powerful brand, as you know, to engage all the community into movement. Thank you very much.
Eleonora, thank you. So you've seen there, I think, three very different versions of basically the same model in three very different cities. We have about 10 minutes now to throw this open for some debate before you're going to do some work. Yes, come and join us, Espen, as well. I'd like to go first, if I may, back to Fiona, because you've been listening to the three cities here. Just give us your kind of appraisal of the different models, perhaps starting with Liverpool.
Thank you very much. It was fascinating to listen to the progress that's being made in these three examples, and they really are world-leading examples here. I spotted some commonality, and if I may briefly, that you're joining up and you're coordinating. It sounds obvious, but in fact that is a tremendous achievement to have established the systems to do that. You're planning and evaluating, so you can see progress, and you are determined and setting directions. I think these four elements were common. To answer your question about specific elements, Maurice, I thought you're asking the people what they want. Health is so good at just delivering something we think you need. So you are engaging the community, and I love the app, and I'd like to look up your app and see how you're inviting the community to be involved. Espen in Lillehammer analysing the environment and using it to plan forward where you put childcare centres and playgrounds. Fantastic example of health and environment doing their best to create the right city. And Eleanor, it was music to my ears to see an ecosystem just being illustrated. No better example of exactly what we're talking about for every country. And so I just applaud your work here and think this connected up whole of ecosystem is exactly the way to go. Thank you.
Thanks, Fiona. Now, I can see, I think here, we have a number of the stakeholders and leaders, indeed, of this Global Active Cities project. Can I bring a microphone, please? First of all, to Philippe. Philippe, can you tell us who you are? Do we have a microphone here, or perhaps I can take this one? There we are, Philippe. Tell us who you are, and tell us why the IOC has backed this project.
Thank you very much, Bill. Thank you, everyone. I work with the International Olympic Committee for the Youth Olympic Games, including sustainability and legacy, and of course, for us, there's a huge interest in helping our cities deliver the best possible legacy of the Games. As Eleonora said, it's an amazing brand that can bring people around the table. And we have now to put the focus on the quality of life of people. We have to demonstrate and get the evidence that a major event like the Youth Olympic Games and the Olympic Games can really change the lives of the host citizens for the better. So we have great hopes in that solution for the future host cities, but also for the past cities that are still Olympic cities, and we're working also through the Union of Olympic Cities for that.
Thank you, Philippe. I think I saw Jean-Francois from Tafisa. Where are you? Yes, over here. If we can have a microphone in the middle, please. It's behind you, I think, Jean-Francois. Jean-Francois is from Tafisa. Tell us how other cities, if there are cities here, how can they get involved and what do they have to do?
Yeah, thank
you. Yeah, you're on.
No, hello, yeah. Thank you very much. Indeed, there are various ways to be involved with the Active Wellbeing Initiative and the Global Activity Program. Cities can join, but not only. We are also working with national Olympic committees and also with governments and national organizations which want to work with their own cities in their countries to help them become more. So it's an inclusive and open process. For cities, once again, it's open. You can contact us, you can join in. First of all, think, see what there is in for you. Yeah, you can sign up to our newsletter and then as a next a partner city. And by becoming a partner city, you will join a network of cities from all will get access to information from Liverpool, Buenos Aires, Lillehammer, Hamburg is here as well, for example, these days, from Richmond in Canada, and you will join a community-wide with whom you can share experiences. We'll provide you with guidelines, with a standard, some criteria, information, how you can pull together your strategies, your programs, your even and we will be able to accompany you throughout the process. I will not go too much into the details now, but people from the team, maybe you can stand up so that everybody can recognize you, are available during these days, during
stand
the Olympism Action Forum. You are welcome to come to talk to us. We will be at the marketplace at the end of the afternoon at 5:30. And we organize the first Global Activity Summit in partnership with Eleonora from Buenos Aires on the 9th and 10th of October in Buenos Aires. So you are welcome to join us to learn more.
Thank you, Jean-Francois. You mentioned Hamburg. I think there's somebody here from Hamburg. Is that right, Andy? Andy, can you tell us why Hamburg has joined the program?
I think that as probably all bigger cities, we have to ask ourselves the question, what can we do for a good future of our city and for a good life of our citizens in the future? And we think that in a very general perspective, sport is vital for that. It's the one thing, it's about a quality of life. I think we can only keep the acceptance for a further growth of our city if the quality of life is growing at the same time. And we can only achieve that by sports. So it's health, it's mobility, it's fun, it's the individual quality of life which is delivered by sport. And the second thing is that we have to stay together as a society, even in a time when we become more and more diverse and we are divided along many lines, many different backgrounds. And sports can show us how we stay one society, can give us a picture how we can build one community across all differences. And for those two basic reasons, we started our Active City program in 2016, including many of the components we heard here, having a big program for infrastructure to make all the sports opportunities very easily accessible for everybody everywhere in the city. So we invested a large effort in infrastructure, not only the classic infrastructure, but also in the public spaces, in the parks, so that everybody, when he steps out of his home, he will find an easy way to physically exercise. And second, of course, sports for all. We work very intensively with handicapped people, with the very young people. We have a program for the kindergartens to teaching the very, very young child to becoming physically active from the first months, and then, of course, hopefully accompanying them for all of their life. Building up partnerships so that not only the classic sports stakeholders promote the program, but also companies, institutions, not only my ministry, but also all other ministries of the city state of Hamburg, and so on. So we make it a very broad movement.
Thank you very much, Andy Grote, who's the Minister of Sport in Hamburg. I have lots of questions raised by what I've heard, but actually I'd like to hear if you have any questions. We have time for maybe just one or two questions. Does anyone wish to raise a question for the team here or any of the organizers? Yes, there's one here.
Yanis Pitsilatis, IOC Medical Commission. One common theme amongst all the cities was that you're using very much a carrot approach to motivate. But from evolutionary biology, we know that we are designed to be lazy. That's part of our reason why we, the way we designed. And so don't we have to also start thinking out of the box and try and find ways that not only trying to motivate, because we know that motivation is a problematic way, is to also try and use a stick. I know people don't want to use that word, and I'm sure we can use a more modernized version of it. But I think a lot of the motivational approaches are going to fail. We need to do something a bit more creatively. Question.
Great question. Thank you. Indeed, someone said to me that maybe we should take away the escalators and take away and force us to go up the stairs. Well, Morris, any thoughts from you?
Yeah, I agree
Microphone
with you.
As close as you can.
I think that one of the things that we've done is to think about that insight-driven approach, which is going to the population and finding out what resonates with them and what helps them. And if you like, what we've done is our stick approach is to go through health. So we know that the population, 70% each year, will go through primary care. Now, what we've done is we said, that's our stick. It's a subtle stick, but it's a way of saying to everybody who goes through, if we can, look, have a conversation about physical activity. Talk about it's an improvement. Ask the question. Give some advice, as well as lining up all of the other priorities, all of the incentives around that, so that we have, if you like, that as a stick, but we also have an offer. We also can say there is something you can do, because the worst thing you can do with any type of professional is say, ask somebody a question, but there's nothing you can do about it. They get demotivated very quickly, believe you me. So I think that we've got to be careful about saying we're going to motivate everybody. We've more, I think, got to engage them in some commitment. And I think commitment's a better way of thinking about it, because I'm doing it because I believe it will do something for me, rather than just because it's somehow good in an airy-fairy way. It's better for me because it reduces my risk of hospital admission. It's better for me because I feel more energy. I feel more relaxed. Some real positive benefits.
Thank you, Morris. Maybe one more brief question. Yes, there's one right at the back here, please.
Yes. Hello. Sanjay from Mauritius. I'm just wondering, we have been speaking about children, we have been speaking about maybe the age, the retired person, but the one which is the most, which should be the most healthy one, which is a working population. And sometimes we see they're all taken up with the work from 7 to 7, and they are not have the enough time and enough possibilities and facilities to be as active as they should be to be healthy. So what do you propose in this example that you have? Thank you.
Maybe Eleonora?
We are working, we are doing some agreements with companies. We need that the companies should talk to employees about the what it means to be active, and also to give the opportunity to be active. The other thing, we are connecting how you arrive to work
for example, we are developing some applications promoting walking. And also connected with the other question, it's not only motivation but also incentives. So we are developing, for example, some app where you can have incentives if you city incentive if you walk, and if you're a group of friends, you will double your incentive because we are trying to get the peer motivation again. So going to, for example, walking to school with your kids or going to work should be part of that active.
Thank you, Eleonora. There's one question I think that has not yet come up, and I'll ask it on behalf of you all. This project sounds fantastic, but I worry that it also might sound to many of us very expensive. Are programs like this going to add enormously to the local tax bill? Fiona?
No, because the cost of chronic disease that the health departments and the communities are already paying far outweighs the sensible ideas that we're seeing here. So preventing the chronic disease will actually pay dividends. If I may take the opportunity just to extend the comment, because I was interested in the question about the stick, and I'll turn, unlike my colleagues here, and say there is a stick, and the stick is going to be to governments and city mayors, because it's the environment. The environment determines behavior, and it's the behaviors that encourage using your car, parking outside your office, parking outside your shops, and more road space in cities going to parking and cars. So we need metrics, and we need metrics and regulations that will demand and require cities to provide the parks, spaces, and places. And that is written in here, because behavior follows the environment.
Thank you, Fiona. Now, in a moment, there'll be more opportunities to ask questions of the panel and of yourselves. But can I remind you that the three global cities we've heard here, and indeed Hamburg, Ljubljana, and Richmond, Canada, are all going to be granted their formal status as a global active city in the awards ceremony at 5:45 this evening. So please go on and give them a big cheer. So I guess we've established that the world is urbanizing rapidly, that this brings great benefits and some tough challenges in terms of health and lifestyle for future citizens. We've heard a sobering analysis from Fiona of those issues, and then we heard three diverse cases for how we can respond to those challenges. Well, now it's your chance to contribute to what happens next. You're seated in these informal groups rather than in rows for a reason. We'd like you to spend the next 10 minutes, please, discussing what you've heard and focusing your discussions on two questions, please. Two very important questions. Can I have question one up on the screen, please? And you will need your app again so that you can submit an answer. But the first question, as you can see, is what is your suggestion for what the Olympic movement can do to help to contribute to this project and to its and to the impetus behind it? You can submit answers as individuals or as a group through the app, and I'll come around and explain how you do that whilst you're doing it. But we'll collect all of your answers, and they will help us to frame what happens next. And the second part of your work is an individual question, and this is why you all have a postcard. It's got information on the front about the Active Cities program, but on the back, it's a postcard. And you'll see there's a space for your name and your address, but there's also space for you to make an individual and personal commitment for what you are going to do about these issues. It might simply be, I'm going to walk up the stairs instead of take the lift in future. Or it might be, I'm going to go back and discuss this idea with the mayor of my city and see what we can do. So you have the chance to make an individual pledge, write on it, put it under your seat. This is very old tech. But the advantage is we will collect these and post them back to you in the old-fashioned mail in about a month's time, when maybe you've forgotten all this. And it'll turn up on your doorstep and you'll be reminded of the session, of the Active Cities program, and of your own personal commitment. Now, the panelists are going to come round whilst you're having your discussions for, yes, 10 minutes, please, and see if you can focus on the big question for the whole of the Olympic movement and your own personal question. Thank you very much. We'll regather in 10 minutes. So keep going. Thank you, everybody. I don't want to stop the discussion, really, because I can hear great debates and great creativity wherever I go. Can I invite our panelists to come back on the stage, please? Espen, yes, if you can come up here. Fiona, if I can invite you to come and join us. I've lost Morris. Where's Morris? Morris, if you can join us up here as well, please. And Eleonora. Eleonora, if you can join us back on stage, please. So let's just get a sample of the kind of things you've been coming up with. I'm going to come round randomly to one or two groups, and I'd like you to tell us what your proposal is. It can either be your individual commitment on the postcard or your proposal for the Olympic movement. Let's have a listen. There was lots of discussion from this group here. Tracy?
Thanks, Bill.
Right into the microphone.
Well, what we were discussing is how the Olympic movement has a huge presence globally. It has a brand that can be used to be leveraged with the Healthy Cities movement. And the IOC can take the opportunity of working with the active cities and making sure that in conjunction with each other, they're able to push forward an agenda that is much more community-based, and also start looking at ways in which grassroots community members can be involved and not just focusing on the high-performance agenda of the IOC.
Thank you, Tracy. I think I heard they're making a greater connection between the games, when the games come to the city, and the city's long-term sporting contribution. Let's go over here. Yes, there's one. We can have a microphone right behind you there, sir. Right behind you. There we are. Quickly as you can. Yes, can we have the microphone on, please?
Michał Brunikowski, Poland. We had an issue with starting people to be active because WHO recommendation is 60 minutes a day. And for some people, the gap between me not being active at all and 60 minutes of the recommended amount is, it's a big gap. So we suggested using Olympic athletes sparking figures, sparking people, starting the activities at low intensity and even small amounts of 15 minutes in a time would be better for them than not being active at all. So and I think WHO needs to think about the issue as well. The recommendation for the people that want to start. For me, 60 minutes at once, straight away, regular, it's too much.
Thank you, Team Poland. We'll come back to you in a moment, Fiona, if we may. There's one over here, I think. Sarah?
Good afternoon, everybody. Together with my colleague, Dr. Jonas, Secretary General of the Afghanistan NOC, I'm Secretary General of the International Ski Federation. We spoke on behalf of the respective commitments that our organizations, who are obviously main stakeholders within the Olympic movement, have to supporting and proactively encouraging active society, and talked about the fact that whilst a main focus of our activities are related to competition sport, either organizing it or putting the teams together, nevertheless, these should also be facilitators to stimulate active society and serve as role models. And we should very much use the positions that we have in order to realize we have a strong responsibility, but also opportunity to reach out, especially to youngsters and especially to families, and sell the virtues and show the benefits of being active. And our friends in Lillehammer are very much speaking on behalf of skiing and, in fact, all of the winter sports. One of our excellent organizers, but also active partners when it comes to the FIS Bring Children to the Snow campaign, which we've been organizing now for 10 years, designed exactly to fulfill this important role of creating active societies.
Sarah, thank you. It's great to hear that the federations are fully bought into this. Actually, Sarah, I couldn't help noticing that you were writing very actively on your postcard. I mean, if it's entirely private, we'll leave it to you, but would you be prepared to read out what you've promised to do as your personal pledge?
Yeah, it's not just a postcard to my dad, but it says that I'll proactively encourage and support FIS initiatives such as Bring Children to the Snow, which aim to use snow sport to have active, healthy youngsters and families.
Great, so, fantastic, good example of
said,
a pledge.
There we
and
are.
If you put that under your chair now and everybody else do the same, the magic post person will take them away and post them to you in the future.
It's like Christmas, isn't it?
Does anybody else want to share a proposal, either individually or group?
Great, thank you.
Yes, we've got one here. Can we have the microphone over this side, please? And then we'll have to wrap it up, I think.
Okay. Well, I'll share the group proposals here. I'm Alisi. I work for Nike in the Community Impact team. And we have a group from Rwanda, Buenos Aires, Canada, very diverse. We talked about urban environments, so for instance, for the cities that host the Olympics, how can the Olympic movement maybe lower expectations on the facilities, the venues for the competitions, so that they don't spend so much money on building the stadiums, but investing that money, for instance, in creating an urban environment that could be more safe and more motivated for people to be active on a daily way. We spoke about how we need to inspire people, not only through the competition, but for to be active for life, and starting with kids, it needs to be fun. It can't be, you know, 4 hours of training to become an Olympian as well, if we want them to be happy. We spoke about awareness. If we want sport for all, we need to have awareness all the time, not only when the Olympics come, and using those big athletes, big legends that only Olympians can be to inspire them.
Thank you so much. Some great contributions there, and I hope you've submitted them all on the app. If you haven't done so yet, please do so, because we'll capture them all before we go. Now, I'm going to ask our panelists just to give us a final word each. Based on what you've heard, what is your impression? Eleonora, are you more optimistic at the end of this session or less optimistic about the future for urban living? It's one word. More optimistic. Morris, if you have to give a tip to cities following your lead in Liverpool, what would it be? We need the microphone, please.
My tip would be ask your citizens what they want to get and how they receive the message, so that you can key into their ideas, their concerns, their expectations. Don't impose something from above.
Don't impose from above. Espen, your advice?
One advice would be that more cities should join the Global Active City program, because I think for Lillehammer it's a lot to learn from Liverpool and Buenos Aires and all the others, and hopefully it will be possible for other cities to develop their cities in a great way, also as a result of being part of this program.
Thank you, Espen. And I've got a special task for you, Fiona. We don't necessarily always think about the World Health Organization as giving out gifts and prizes, but I'd like you to select two great proposals and ideas that you heard and see if you can give them something to remember.
Well, you're right. WHO tends to do a lot of talking, but we're moving into the world of walking the talk, and we have our own worksite health program to make sure that we're actually putting this into practice. And to make sure that we build on the communication, if I could ask for your help to help open this bag for me and pass me one of those, thank you very much, because we need to be better at communicating. So we put the whole presentation on a football. Be more active every day. Let's be active, everyone, everywhere, every day. And that's a sentiment I think we've shared today. Everyone, the least active, the old, the young, women and men, everywhere, in all countries, at school, at work, at home, and every day, because it's regular. I'd like to pick up the comment about the least active people being a priority, because I agree, the greatest gains and the greatest needs are those who are not very active and are put off by everything we do. So the gentleman that raised that issue, and I'll talk to you about the recommendations from WHO after, was it this gentleman here? Please. You may play together. Thank you for your comment. And secondly, I think the spirit of your question was asking what the movement can do, and I heard a lot of people talking about how it needs to promote participation. Move from the struggles, the sweat, and the podiums to more of everyone participating and enjoying it, and we need to communicate that, and I love the comment by my colleague here. So I'd like you to take this home and start communicating with this football.
Thank you, Fiona.
And I haven't got a football for everyone, but I have got a whole pile of these. So I think we should all start walking the talk. And I invite you to come and get one after this. Thank you.
So thank you very much. We need to wrap up here. There's clearly much to think about. We've only touched the surface, but I hope you feel we've given you a lot to think about. You've certainly given us things to think about. Submit your proposals. Leave your postcards underneath. Thank you all for participating and for joining in with this session, and would you all join me in thanking our speakers? Thank you very much.